So we are in this section for models of European options on interest rate. And what I have just shown you is that we can very easily derive a Black-Scholes-like formula for the valuation of a cap rate, assuming a log normal process for the forward rate, yeah? So for our interest rate. And we actually could do the proof on a single slide, yeah, if we like, because we have this generalized Black-Scholes formula, where we just need that the index is a martingale under a certain measure that is associated with a financial product that also appears somehow in the payoff, huh? Is associated with the payoff. So to see that the principles that we use work also for other models, let's repeat another important model, the Bachelier model. So in the Bachelier model, we now assume that the interest rate here L1 follows a normal dynamic. So now I have not a log normal process, I have here a normal dynamic. So you see there's just a sigma dw here. So in contrast to the Black-Scholes model, it was sigma L1 dw. So it was a log normal process. Recall, we like to calculate the value of the caplet as in this definition. So let's just copy this definition here. Whoops. I like to calculate the value of the payoff that is L1 fixed at the beginning of the period minus K and zero multiplied with the period length. I pay 1 unit of currency. And this is my payoff, which I receive in T2. Yeah? So the payment time is T2. Okay, so same task, just a different model. So we proceed in the same steps. We observe that L is a martingale under the measure that is associated with certain numerator. And we choose here again the PT2 bond as the numerator. So then we just conclude that L1 is a martingale. It is the ratio of a portfolio of traded assets divided by the numerator. So I can immediately see that the stochastic process under this measure Qn is now just sigma dw. So I know that this guy is normally distributed. So with mean is just L1 of zero, and the standard deviation is just coming from the integrated variance. Yeah, integral of sigma squared dt gives you the accumulated variance over time. So the standard deviation is sigma times square root of t. So you know the distribution of L at any future time. So then I calculate the option value by calculating analytically here this expectation. So I need to calculate the expectation of my payoff function. The payoff function is maximum of L minus K multiplied with the period length. And now L is just normal distributed. Okay, so you have to solve an integral like before. So I don't do that, yeah, because it's just proceeding in very similar steps. Actually, it's even a little bit easier. And in the end, you arrive at this formula, which looks a little bit similar to our Black-Scholes formula, but a few terms are different. So of course we have here in front our numerator observed today, because this is the units in which we pay. And then we also have our index, the martingale minus the strike, yeah, observed today, and a few parameters that involve the model parameters, yeah, the sigma. So sigma occurs here inside the D plus minus, which is here and here, and we have the density of the normal distribution appearing here. So I spare a little bit the derivation of the integral, but you see that apart from this step, that the derivation of the integral is different. The steps proceed in the same way. Yeah? Choose the numerator wisely. Then you know the distribution of the stuff inside the expectation and calculate the expectation. Okay, so that is the formula for the value of a caplet under the Bachelier model. The Bachelier model is nice because it allows negative interest rates. Yeah? The Plaque model does not allow negative interest rates. So the Bachelier model would allow negative interest rates. The interest rate is now normal distributed. Okay. So we have time left to do the swaption. And the Plaque model for the swaption is really another nice example, because it will bring up the choice of the numerator again. And you see that the choice of the numerator here is maybe not so trivial as it appeared in the previous part. So in the previous part, our numerator was the zero coupon bond that is won at the payment time. And actually, our numerator in the previous part was just a scaling of the numerator that also appeared in the Black-Scholes model for a stock. So still, it was very similar. Okay, so now how do we do the swaption? Let's go back to the definition of the financial products. So while we defined the caplet here as we know the payment at payment time as a function, the definition of the swaption was a little bit different. The swaption was an option on the swap, and inside the maximum function here, there is the value of the swap. So there was here the swaption. So the swaption is an option on the swap. So here we have the swap. So first I have to define a little bit my swap. So my swap has a time discretization. So I have given 10 or times. So this here we swap denotes the swap as in definition 136. And my swaption is now here this option on the swap. The maximum of the value of the swap observed in T1. Yeah? So I know the value of this in T1. So what was the swap? So the swap was a sequence of payments. Yeah? So we paid the forward rate for the period from TI to TI plus one observed in TI. We paid it minus a constant multiplied with the period length at the end of the period. So this was done for all the i's. So it means that we have here multiple payments. So this means if I value this, yeah, if you go back, so this is just repeating here a little bit the valuation of the swap. The value of the swap at an earlier time is the sum of all these payments evaluated. So this here is now the value at time little t. And we derive that the value is given by taking the observed forward rate in little t, and all the values here are multiplied with the observed zero coupon bond price corresponding to the payment time. So, and now I have an option on this complicated sum. Yeah, so we have a maximum of the value of the swap fixed at the beginning of the first period and zero. So how can we do this? Now, it appears to be super complicated because actually you have here multiple random variables inside. So do we need a vector valued model where we have a model for every L, for every different L, and we have correlations and so on? You can do that with such a model. That will be our discretized forward rate model later. But you can derive a very short, very nice formula if you take a slightly different view to the swaption. And this involves rewriting the value of the swap. So let's do that because it's nice. Remember that we defined an interest rate that was associated with the value of the swap. It was the par swap rate. So we defined here the par swap rate by this expression. Okay, so what is this par swap rate? It is the constant rate S such that the value of the swap is zero. If you take all the SI to be equal this special interest rate. So we had here this nice property that the value of the swap became zero. So this here is the defining property of the par swap rate. Okay, so why is that useful? Yeah, I can take here this valuation and I do not modify if I subtract the zero from it. No, I do not modify this if I subtract the zero from it. So let's subtract the zero. And what I subtract is exactly this zero here. And when you subtract this zero, all these guys here will vanish. So I have the value of the swap is given as this sum. So this is the original sum I had with all my little forward rates here. Okay. Then I subtract the par swap rate from this. Okay, so if I subtract the par swap rate from this, I have here this part which is zero. And I have minus minus the par swap rate minus SI. So what I'm left is just the sum over the par swap rate minus the SI. So it's the SI in the coming from the original swap. So you see what I'm left is I can rewrite the swap as the difference of the par swap rate and the constant SI. Okay, so the nice thing is that here only one stochastic process appears. So this is here the only random variable. So the value of the swap depends on a single random variable, namely the par swap rate. And so now the situation is much easier because now I only need to write down a model for this object. And I can assume maybe a Black-Scholes model, a Black model for the swap rate. So you see, the nice thing is that we can rewrite the swaption as an option on the swap rate. So if all the SIs here are, say, for example, the same, so we assume that all the SIs are identically the same, say K, then you can move this here in front of the sum, and you have that this is equal to the password rate minus k multiplied with this sum. And this sum is actually just something which we had defined before here. This sum that is left over is the so-called swap annuity. So we had this before. This is here the swap annuity. It's the sum that is related to, so now important, related to the way the swap is paying. All the periods multiplied with the zero coupon bond corresponding to the payment dates. So this swap annuity is somehow the unit in which the swap pays the swap rate. Yeah, so hopefully you get all these analogies. So you see that this stuff which is left over here, is the swap annuity. So I have that this is equal to paying the par swap rate observed in T minus the S. So if all the S's are the same, it's the K multiplied with this swap annuity. So you see also that the swap annuity here is positive. So if you now take the maximum of this and zero, maximum of the value of the swap and zero, it's the maximum of this and zero multiplied with a financial product. Wow, that's nice. And the financial product is exactly associated with how the swap is paying. That's exactly the same form as for the caplet. Okay, so a little bit nicer here on the slide, yeah, not so colorful. I can reinterpret the value of the swap as paying the difference of the par swap rate, my stochastic value, and a constant rate here, k. So I assume all the k's here are all the si's are the same, multiplied with the swap annuity. So we had here the swap annuity again. So now the option, the swaption is the maximum of the value of the swap is of this form. So that was a little prologue to rewrite the swaption in a form that is accessible to a very nice, very simple model. Because now I have exactly the form as before. I have here a single index that I will model like a stochastic process. Well, a little bit, it's still difficult because my swap annuity here is a complicated stochastic object. So do I need to model the index, interest rates? And do I need to model the swap annuity with a stochastic model, which also is related to interest rates? Yeah. So you see here, this is also fixed at T1, at the exercise state of the option. And all these guys here are random variables. So still it appears to be more complicated. Yeah, I just have disguised the complexity a little bit. Okay, so let's start. We assume that the par swap rate follows a log normal model. So that's the same as for the Black model for the caplet. I assume this dynamic under P. And now I choose the numerator and choose the numerator wisely, and my candidate for the numerator is here this swap annuity. Okay, if you choose the swap annuity, you see that the par swap rate is a martingale. So where was that? Let's go back. So that's the definition of the par swap rate. So you see that the par swap rate is a portfolio of traded assets divided by the swap annuity. So the pass swap rate is a martingale under the equivalent martingale measure if you choose the swap annuity as numeraire. Okay, so that's also nice. Yeah, we move to QA. We know that this is a martingale, so I know the drift is zero. So I know that I have my Black-Scholes formula in exactly the same way as we had it before. Yeah. So the reason is that in my valuation formula, I have the value at t zero is my numeraire in zero multiplied with the expectation of the payoff. So now the payoff is maximum of the pass swap rate minus k and zero, but I pay in units of the swap annuity, divided by my numeraire. And you see that the numeraire vanishes inside the expectation. So that's the reason why I do not need an additional model for this swap annuity, because actually inside the expectation, it is vanishing because I pay in units of the swap annuity. So we get the same nice Black-Scholes formula as we had before. And you see that, so you see I pay here this index in units of the swap annuity. Okay, so we have our nice Black-Scholes formula for the swaption. So of course, we can also look at the valuation of the swaption under the Bachelier model. But now, since you have seen how we can rewrite the swaption as an option on the swap rate, where the swap rate is a martingale under the measure when we choose the annuity as the numeraire, and that you have seen that the valuation is then following exactly the same lines as for the caplet. So you see that the Bachelier model for the swaption is really just the same. So we write the swaption as an option on the swap. The assumption for the swap rate is that we now follow a Bachelier model. So we follow a normal model. So the diffusion part here is just the sigma dw. Okay, so if we now move to our numeraire, so we take the swap annuity as numeraire, we know that this guy is a martingale under this measure QA, and then we can value the option. Well, the option is then the option here on S minus K, yeah, the maximum of S minus K, and the numeraire is here our swap annuity. Okay, so we get the Bachelier formula where the numeraire is the swap annuity and the index is the swap rate. Yeah, all the remaining parts are as before in the Bachelier formula. Okay, and to conclude this session, yeah, what about a swaption on the backward rate? Well, there we have our little lemma. So this was lemma 122. So if you look at this lemma, it told us that if we value a forward rate paid at the end of the period or a backward rate paid at the end of a period at an earlier point in time, so before period start, then the two value agree. Yeah. So the time S value of paying the backward rate in capital T is independent of the discretization. So we could just use a single time step, which then means that the backward rate is equal to the forward rate. And that little lemma then allowed us to conclude that the valuation of a swap on the backward rate agrees with the valuation of a swap on the forward rate. So hence we can conclude that a swaption, where the underlying swap pays the backward rate, will result in the same valuation formula. So depending here on the model, so a Black model or a Bachelier model, so we get just the corresponding formula. But a small warning, this does not apply to caplet, cap, floorlet, or floor. Okay, so why is that? Well, there we had an option on receiving this coupon. And if this year's time, so say the simulation time of your stochastic process, and this year is the period, then the forward rate, so let me mark the forward rate here in green, will have some stochastic movement, and then it will be fixed at this point here, while the backward rate is fixed at the end of the period. So this is fixed at the end of the period, which means there is a longer period of volatility. For the swap, this didn't make a difference because we were actually observing the value of the swap at the beginning of the swap. So we're observing the value, so we were taking the expectation of that part. But for a caplet, that's not the case. So the forward rate, this is a fixing at the beginning of the period, and this makes a difference in the valuation of the option. So you have to be a little bit careful there. Yeah, you have to derive, well, a new valuation formula for the caplet on the backward rate. Yeah, that concludes my session. Well, I have a reference in this session. So that was the one to hear Prigo Mercurio, nice book on interest rate models. All these models that were here discussed in this section are also in my book. And that was it for today. Thank you.